Welcome to Living Word.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Well, hello, I'm Pastor Kathleen Casper, and this is Living Word. Living Word is a teaching program, and currently we are working our way through the Gospel of John. And as we are doing this, we are getting a different picture of Jesus than we do in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It is a picture of Jesus and how he relates to the Father. And in that relationship, we get to know how we then can relate to Jesus and the Father as well. Let's begin now with a word of prayer. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for the day that you have given to us. It is indeed a day full of blessings from you. Heavenly Father, now as we continue the study of John and as we are proceeding closer and closer to his arrest and the trial and the crucifixion that he undergoes for us, we pray, O Lord, that you would touch us in such a way that we might be drawn closer to you more than ever before as we understand this word, maybe in a new way, maybe in a way that we have never heard it before. And so we ask you to bless this word in Jesus' name. Amen. Last time we met, we read through John chapter 12. The time before Passover and Jesus' arrest and passion were approaching quickly. At a meal in Jesus' honor, Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, anointed Jesus' feet with expensive perfume and then wiped his feet with her hair. She was actually, we found out later, she was preparing Jesus for his burial. The chief priests were moving forward in their plans to kill Jesus, only now they were planning to kill Lazarus as well. For on account of him, on account of Lazarus, and the fact that Jesus raised him from the dead, many of the Jews were going to Jesus and putting their faith in him. The day after Mary anointed Jesus' feet with that costly perfume, Jesus made his way to Jerusalem. And the great crowd that had come for the feast, that Passover feast, heard that Jesus was on his way. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, and that fulfilled a particular prophecy, a prophecy from Zechariah. Zechariah 9, verse 9, we hear, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." The praises of the crowd only angered the Pharisees all the more. They had to act, and they had to act quickly. When some Greeks who had come to worship at the feast asked to see Jesus, we heard the words the entire cosmos was longing to hear. "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." The hour had finally come. The plan of God, spoken of in Genesis 3 by God to the serpent, was about to reach its climax. Jesus, the good shepherd of the sheep, was about to lay down his life for the sheep. The kernel of wheat would be falling to the ground, and it would die. And in the dying, it would be producing many, many seeds. But Jesus also speaks of the call upon the lives of those who would follow him, those who would be his disciples. And he said, "The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life." The time had come, but Jesus' heart was troubled. He knew he would go through the plans and purposes of the Father, but he also knew that it would be excruciatingly painful. But the time had come for judgment on this world and for the prince of this world to be driven out of it. Unfortunately, we have this statement made about the crowd to whom Jesus had been speaking, and this is in John 12, verse 37. even after Jesus had done all these miraculous signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. But then when we jump to verse 42, we hear, yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him. Jesus came as the light of the world, but many loved the darkness, so they refused to come to his light. John 13, verse 1. It was just before the Passover feast. Now, John's gospel does not have the account of a Passover meal like Matthew, Mark, and Luke have. But the record we have in John's gospel, which refers to the eating and the drinking of the body and blood of Jesus, goes way beyond the accounts that we have in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the Passover is being celebrated, and the Passover meal is being eaten. And it's during that Passover meal that Jesus takes the bread, gives thanks for it, breaks it, and gives it to his disciples and says, take and eat, this is my body. In the same manner, he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. In John's gospel, we learned of our great need to eat and drink of the body and blood of Christ in a much more graphic manner. This is what Jesus says in John chapter 6. He says, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. In verse 51 of John chapter 6, Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. Then just two verses later in John 6:53, Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. After Jesus explained that he was the bread of life and that whoever eats his flesh and drinks his blood has eternal life, many turned away from following him. When Jesus asked his own disciples if they wanted to leave him too, Peter spoke up and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. Jesus, even knowing that one among the 12 would betray him, continued to show his love to his disciples. And after we read, it was just before the Passover feast, we read, Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. Now that's interesting. It's interesting that Holy Spirit would inspire John to write, he now showed them the full extent of his love. In one sense, it seems hardly the case that what Jesus was about to do would show the disciples the full extent of his love. Jesus was about to wash his disciples' feet. How could that act show them the full extent of his love? Wasn't his death on the cross going to do that? Yes, but. Verse 2. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. What in the world was Jesus doing? He was doing what the culture in that day expected of the lowest of servants. But Jesus was their Lord. Jesus was their teacher. So what was he doing? He was showing them how to be servant leaders. When Jesus came to Simon Peter said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, Unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Let's not read past Jesus' answer too quickly, because it is vital to us as it was to Peter. Jesus answered, Unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Unless we allow Jesus to wash us, we have no part with him. Peter's knee-jerk reaction to Jesus was his taking offense to what Jesus was doing. Peter didn't know, however, that if he continued to refuse Jesus' action to wash his feet, he would have been saying to Jesus, I don't need you. He would have been saying to Jesus, I can come on my own before the Father in my own righteousness. Yikes! The trouble for Peter was this. His own righteousness was as filthy as used menstrual cloths. And that's just yuck. He needed to be washed by Jesus. He needed what only Jesus could do for him. The same is true for each person on earth. In order for a person to have a part with Jesus, we have got to let him wash us. His righteousness is perfectly pure. His righteousness is white as freshly fallen snow. Jesus was using water to wash his disciples' feet, to show them their need for him to wash them. But it was going to be his blood which would cleanse them of their sin. It is his blood that cleanses us from all sin. After Peter heard Jesus say, Unless I wash you, you have no part with me, Peter replied, Then, Lord, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. But Jesus answered, A person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you. For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. In the Gospel of Luke, Luke records in chapter 22 that during the Passover meal, get this, during the Passover meal, a dispute arose among the disciples as to which one of them was considered to be the greatest. Jesus said to them, The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. Leadership. Leadership in the kingdom of God is not defined as leadership is defined in the world. Leaders in the kingdom of God serve others and serve among everyone. Authority in the kingdom is not based upon rank or position. No one is to lord it over anyone else. No one. Jesus is our master. As he served, so we are to serve. But if we don't allow Jesus to wash us, then we aren't clean and we don't belong to him. It takes a humble heart to recognize that we need Jesus. It takes a humble heart for us to know that we can't come to the Father on our own. Unfortunately, though Jesus had washed everyone's feet, he knew that there was one who was counted among the disciples who was there around that table who didn't really belong to him. This man was not clean, for he had aligned himself with the devil. And this was Judas Iscariot. When Jesus said, and you are clean, though not every one of you. He added, I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen. But this is to fulfill the scripture. He who shares my bread has lifted up his heel against me. I am telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am he. I tell you the truth. Whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. Now, Jesus has said these or similar words a number of times in the gospel we have been reading. John chapter 5, verse 24, we heard Jesus say, I tell you the truth. Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. When Jesus was asked what work needed to be done to do the work of God, Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. Now, he is saying, I tell you the truth. Whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me. The people that Jesus is sending out into the world, they are truly representing Jesus. And so if we receive the ones Jesus sends, we are receiving Jesus as well. Verse 20, Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me. His disciples stared at one another at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, ask him which one he means. Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. Then dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, son of Simon. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered him. What you are about to do, do quickly, Jesus told him. But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the feast, or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night. The detail, and it was night, is an interesting detail to include in this gospel, and we wonder, well, why was it added? Could it be that it was added to further express how Judas had aligned himself with the darkness of the evil one, and that the deeds of the devil are often plotted under the cover of darkness? Naturally, we are not told, but for sure, Judas had stumbled because the light of Christ was not in him. When Judas was gone, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. The ways of God are truly not the ways of man. Jesus was about to be arrested, tried, beaten, lifted up on the cross, and crucified. And it was through this means that he would be glorified. But he was accomplishing the plans and purposes of God, which had been determined to be carried out in this manner before the creation of the world. So it was in this sense that what Jesus was about to do, what he was about to accomplish, it was in this sense that he would bring glory to both him and God. The fulfilling of God's plans and purposes does this. God is glorified, and so Jesus is glorified as well. Then Jesus continued, he said, my children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Love one another. The little word as told his disciples how they were to love. They were to love as, that is, in the same way that Jesus loved them. The love they were to have for each other was to be no different than Jesus loved them. The purpose of their loving each other as Jesus loved them was clear. When they loved each other as Jesus loved them, all people would know that they were Jesus' disciples. The same is true today. When believers love each other as Jesus loves us, the world knows that we are Jesus' disciples. The world takes notice. Our programs may never touch anyone, but love will. How well do we love each other in the household of faith? If we do not love well, we are not being good representatives of Christ in the world. Now, Peter has heard the command to love, but he has also heard Jesus say, "My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come." This disturbs Peter. What does Jesus mean, he's going away? But Peter could not follow him. So Simon Peter asked him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus replied, "Where I am going, you cannot follow now, but you will follow later." Peter asked, "Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you." And Jesus answered, "Will you really lay down your life for me? I tell you the truth, before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. Jesus knew Peter better than Peter knew himself. It would not take long for Peter to learn that Jesus was absolutely correct. Peter would deny knowing Jesus, effectively disowning him 3 times. It wouldn't be until the rooster crowed that Peter would wake up to the fact that he had done exactly what Jesus said he would do. Then Peter would go out and weep bitterly. The news about Jesus' betrayal and Peter's denial must have shaken the disciples. Their world may have seemed to be coming unhinged or spinning out of control. To bring comfort to his disciples, Jesus says, beginning in John 14, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." These were comforting words for sure. Jesus was going away, but he would come back. He was going to prepare a place for them. He wanted his disciples to be with him, but preparations needed to be made for them to join him. What Jesus has said was easily understandable. And maybe there would not have been any more questions or confusion, except Jesus went on to say, "You know the way to the place where I'm going." But did they know the way to the place he was going? And if they knew the way to the place he was going, well, why couldn't they join Jesus now? You know, maybe Jesus had mentioned something about knowing the way to the place he was going, but so much was happening in such a short period of time. Jesus had broken news to them that one of his own disciples would betray him. He had washed his disciples' feet, and that was unheard of in that culture. He had told another one of his disciples that he would deny him 3 times. So with so much happening at once, maybe the disciples just forgot what Jesus had told them. Thankfully, Thomas asks the question for the rest of the disciples and for us as well. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Okay, now they knew where Jesus was going. Jesus was returning to the Father. He had come from above. He had come from God, and he was returning to God. They also heard again that it was only through Jesus that anyone comes to the Father. We have heard this truth from the beginning of John's Gospel. In John 1, we read, "Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, not of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God." When we read John 5:24, we heard Jesus say, "I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life." Jesus was saying that work needed to be done to do the work of God. He was going to go to prepare a place for them. When it was prepared, he would come back and take them to be where he was. The work they were to do in preparation for preparing for the, you know, the journey to where Jesus was going was to believe that he was the one that God had sent into the world. Jesus alone is the way. Jesus alone is the truth. Jesus alone is the life. He alone is our access to the Father. Now, the world does not want to hear this truth. The world doesn't want to believe this truth. But just because the world doesn't want to hear it or doesn't want to believe it doesn't nullify the fact that this is true. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. There are not many roads that lead to heaven. There is only one road, and that is through Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only way to the Father. He is the truth. He is our life. John began his gospel by writing, "In him was life, and that life was the light of men." Yes and yes, amen and amen. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for the fact that, you know, you continue to show us how your Son is the way, the truth, and the life. You continue to point out to us that the way we come to you and the work that we do in your kingdom is to receive Jesus, believe he is the one that you sent into the world. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the fact that Jesus is our light and our life. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that knowing him, we know you. Thank you for showing us who you are. Thank you for John's gospel. It does give us such insight into the truth, into the relationship that you have with Jesus that we would not have had before. And so we thank you for Holy Spirit inspiring John to write down these words. He had a special relationship with Jesus, but his relationship with Jesus is a relationship we all can have. And so I pray, Heavenly Father, that we would seek such a relationship. Draw us ever closer to you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And let me bless you all. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Bye-bye, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you for joining, Pastor Kathleen. Through this message, we hope that you will have come to know God better. God can be known and wants to be known by each person on earth. God is a communicator. He has given us the Bible, his Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit as means through which he reveals himself and his will to us. God is love. And regardless of what is going on in your life, God loves you and is concerned for you. He is as near as a prayer, and he can be trusted to be faithful to you. Living Word is a listener-supported program. Your prayers and donations are needed to keep this program on the air. Donations can be through the Living Word website or sent to Living Word, P.O. Box 3810, Alice, Texas, 78333-3810. If you have a question you'd like to ask Pastor Kathleen, a comment you'd like to share, or would like to purchase a CD of this message and have access to the Internet, Pastor Kathleen's website is www.livingwordradio.org. If you are in the area and would like to join Pastor Kathleen and the congregation she serves on the weekend, she is pastor of Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Alice, Texas.